Welcome back to Module 4 of Seizures and Epilepsy for Brain-Mind Behavior. In the last module, we worked through the seizure classification system. And as you'll recall, seizures are classified into focal, generalized, and focal with secondary generalization. And I wanted to emphasize that because it's so important in terms of trying to figure out the evaluation of a patient with seizure. And that's what we're going to do now with Module 4. In this module, I want to cover four topics. The first is first aid of a patient if you come across someone who's seizing. The second is a differential diagnosis to consider in someone who presents who may have a seizure. The third is potential causes. And then finally, an initial look at the laboratory workup for a patient with a first-time seizure. So let's dive in. First of all, you may find yourself in a situation where you're out of the hospital, out of the clinic, and come across someone who is having a seizure. And I thought it would be useful for you to simply know the basics of how to manage such a situation. So first of all, the first thing is stay calm and make sure that someone is in charge. You know what? This actually might be you. So you might want to sort of take your pulse and just sort of be kind of calm and then take control of the situation. The first thing is to make sure that the patient is lying down in a safe location. Clear anything away that the person might hurt themselves with by hitting with the tonic or clonic movements, and put something soft under the patient's head. Do a quick assessment of airway, breathing, and circulation. You'll find that if someone's having a full generalized tonic-clonic seizure, that in the midst of the seizure, they actually may not be breathing very well. They may actually turn cyanotic. But once the seizure is ended, respirations almost always return promptly. Of course, if this is not the case, you need to consider administering CPR, and intubation is going to be needed once paramedics and other personnel arrive. As the patient is having their seizure, make sure that they're rolled to the side. Move the head to one direction or the other so that saliva and et cetera can be cleared to try to prevent aspiration. I'm sure you all know this, but do not try to place anything in the patient's mouth during a seizure, such as a tongue blade, a spoon, let alone your finger. Once the patient has clenched down at the beginning of the tonic phase of a seizure, there's nothing that you can do to reverse any of the potential injury that might occur. And in fact, you can actually cause additional injury by forcing someone in the something into the patient's mouth. Sixth thing is to look for a MedAlert tag. To determine whether the patient has a known history of epilepsy. Oftentimes, patients with epilepsy will have a MedAlert tag, either on their wrist or as a necklace, and this will sometimes carry the diagnosis as well as the prescribed medications or other medical problems that the patient has. And then finally, again, if you're outside of the hospital, do you call 911? Well, if it appears that this is a first-time seizure, if the seizure lasts for more than 4 to 5 minutes, and if there is any other indication that there's an acute medical problem, such as the patient having trauma or some metabolic disturbance or any other question, then of course the safe thing to do is to call 911. Okay, so now let's turn to the circumstance where a patient is brought to the hospital because of a concern of them possibly having a seizure. And in this discussion, I'd like to actually focus in primarily on the question of whether or not the patient had a generalized seizure. As you'll remember from the classification system, there are many types of focal seizures, and the discussion about the differential diagnosis of those seizures is to be, we'll put that off for later. But in this case, a patient has been observed to, say, collapse to the ground. They may or may not be completely unconscious. They've had motor movements that might be suggestive of a seizure. This is a very common situation, a very common scenario that presents to the emergency room and to the hospital. And the main issue in the differential diagnosis of this presentation is, did the person actually have a seizure, a generalized seizure, or did they have syncope or a fainting spell? And there are other possibilities that can explain an apparent loss of consciousness. That includes psychogenic non-epileptic events. That is, there are patients who may have everything that looks like a seizure, but it's from a psychological or psychiatric basis. There are various sleep disorders that can cause a sudden loss of tone or loss of consciousness. Migraine, very common disorder, can have some very unusual manifestations that can actually result in a loss of consciousness. And then there are various stroke syndromes, such as transient ischemic attacks. But again, the main differential diagnosis is seizure versus syncope. And in this table, I've elucidated some of the important distinguishing features between syncope and generalized seizure. So first of all, arguably one of the most important characteristics of syncope versus seizure is what was the nature of the onset of the loss of consciousness. In patients who have a fainting spell or have syncope, there's a remarkably stereotypic progression of symptoms. In fact, I'm sure if you've ever had a fainting spell or a near fainting spell, and you compared notes with other people who have had the same event, you'll find that people tend to describe sort of a similar set of symptoms. You may begin to get lightheaded, your heart may start racing, you might become sweaty. As things get more and more progressed, your vision may kind of begin to tunnel down. You might see stars, and then there's this eventual loss of consciousness. This is something that typically takes place over a couple of seconds. Again, if you've experienced this, you know what I'm talking about. That's to be distinguished from a generalized seizure, in which the onset can be highly variable, and it's typical or consistent for a given patient who has had multiple events. But the characteristic findings are nothing like what I've just described for syncope. They may suddenly have a complete loss of consciousness without any warning whatsoever. I've had patients say it's as though someone sort of snuck up behind me and just turned my switch off. Some patients who have a focal onset that rapidly generalizes may describe a variety of symptoms, such as this sensation of a rising feeling in one's stomach or gastric rising. Sometimes patients may describe an odd odor. They may have a deja vu. They may just feel as though there's something going on that they can't quite explain, and then they have their generalized seizure. But again, if these recur, they tend to be stereotypic for a given patient. During the event, patients with syncope oftentimes don't have any movement. And again, if you've watched someone have a syncope event, you see that they generally fall down to the ground. However, observations of people having seizures when done in a careful way indicate that probably at least 50% of patients who have a syncope episode actually have abnormal movements, sometimes shaking. However, if movements occur, they almost always subside within about 10 seconds. On the other hand, someone who's had a generalized seizure, depending on the clinical aspects of it, whether it's tonic-clonic, or so forth, generally, these movements last quite a bit longer than 10 seconds. The average generalized seizure is probably on the order of a minute or so. You'll find observers, especially family members, saying that the person was having movements for 5 minutes or 10 minutes. This is usually not the case. But the movements during the event are almost always much longer than what you might see in a syncope event. When the patient has syncope, their skin color is generally pallid because of loss of blood flow. And this is to be distinguished from cyanosis in someone who's having a generalized seizure, who's having the breathing problems that I mentioned before, as well as the contraction of the thorax. And finally, the recovery phase. Again, with the onset, probably the most critical distinguishing feature between seizure and syncope. Patients who have a typical syncopal episode usually begin recovering their consciousness within a couple of minutes. Now, they may not feel normal over the next few minutes, but by the time they get to 5 minutes or so, and certainly by 10 minutes, they're completely conscious. They may not feel well, but they're able to process language and interact with the examiner, and they basically know where they are. This is quite different than someone who's had a full-blown generalized tonic-clonic seizure. It typically takes many minutes before consciousness even begins to come back towards normal. By 15 minutes, the patient may appear somewhat back to normal, although still confused. And it can take actually a number of hours before they feel that they're completely back to their normal self. I'm emphasizing all this because the main differential diagnosis challenge in someone who presents with a possible seizure is seizure versus syncope. And if you think through the various components of the table that we've just reviewed, it should be pretty clear that the challenge in making this distinction is actually taking the time to get the very, very careful history from the patient or an observer or both in order to really understand what the patient experienced as the onset and the recovery and what others observed. All right, so let's assume that we've concluded that the patient has in fact had a seizure. Now let's consider briefly the potential causes, because the workup or the evaluation of this patient has got to be directed towards the causes as well as the management of the seizure. So I've divided the potential causes of seizures into various age groups, and you'll see on the right-hand side of the slide is a pretty long list of the many causes of seizures and epilepsy. There are many more, but this is a simplified list. And you'll see that there's overlap across the different age groups, but also distinguished patterns. So first of all, for neonates, so for infants that are less than 1 month of age, you can see that there's a variety of causes. I'll let you read them on your own, but they range from perinatal hypoxia to drug withdrawal to CNS infection, genetic disorders, and so forth. Beyond 1 month, the categories shift somewhat. More likely would be CNS infection, a genetic basis, febrile seizures, or trauma. For adolescents, the grouping includes CNS infections, genetic disorders, trauma, brain tumor, and illicit drug use. For adults, trauma, brain tumor, illicit drug use, alcohol withdrawal, and one can begin to get into cerebrovascular disease, although, as you'll see, in older adults, that begins to predominate along with Alzheimer's and other degenerative diseases, alcohol withdrawal, brain tumor, and again, metabolic disturbances. We've just looked at the potential causes of seizures according to age groups. And now I want you to just review the entire list. Just read through the list of the potential causes of seizures. Because I'd now like to discuss with you how you would approach the workup of a patient with a first-time seizure. So think of all these causes, and then the evaluation is going to, in part, be targeted on trying to figure out whether the patient might have one or more of these causes. So, of course, you'll take a careful history, you'll do a complete physical exam and a neurologic exam, and then you'll certainly pursue some laboratory studies. So what laboratory studies would you do? Imagine the patient comes in, clear history of seizures, seems to be generalized tonic-clonic, there's nothing actually clearly abnormal in the physical exam or the neurologic exam. What type of laboratory studies do you want to send off? And I'm sure as you're thinking through this, you'll be sending off a variety of blood studies. And here's a list of some of the typical things that we send off. A CBC, electrolytes, calcium, glucose, screening tests for liver function and renal function, an ESR to look for a, sort of a general marker of immune changes or inflammation. And all of these, again, are tied to at least some of the causes that were listed and that you have to consider. In addition, depending on the age of the patient, you'll want to consider a tox screen because drug toxicity is an important cause of seizures. And depending on the setting, a pregnancy test is going to be appropriate as well. So what else? You've gotten the blood studies. Anything else you want to do out of the emergency department? You'll probably want to do an imaging study. And a CT scan or an MRI scan would be appropriate. We're, in this case, most likely looking for any kind of focal abnormality, focal lesion, that could be the basis of the patient's having had a seizure. In most circumstances still, a CT scan is the only thing that you'll actually be able to get out of the emergency room, although an MRI scan would be preferable because it provides so much more exquisite anatomical detail. An MRI scan is often done as a follow-up in a patient with a first-time seizure or the consideration of epilepsy, and that would usually be scheduled a couple of days later. Any other tests you want to get? So we've gotten blood studies, we've gotten an imaging study. You'll probably want to get an EEG. So as you'll recall from the earlier modules, the EEG can potentially give us an indication of the underlying excitability of the cortex. There are patients who may be predisposed to seizures who will have abnormal EEG findings, such as the spiking activity that we saw on the EEG in the earlier modules. And so an EEG is going to be almost always scheduled for a patient, usually not done out of the emergency room, but something that you should try to obtain in at least a couple of days, a minimum of a couple of days, or a week to two later. Okay, so now that we've covered first aid of seizure, differential diagnosis, the potential causes of seizures and epilepsy, and have thought through the initial evaluation and laboratory workup of a patient with a first-time seizure, In the next module, I'd like to give you a sort of a general broad overview of the treatment of seizures and epilepsy.